base of the hills, on the banks of the river. When the Boer gunfire erupted, Buller's infantry was advancing in quarter column, and his doomed guns were unlimbering and deploying well within accurate rifle range of the Boer entrenchments. To the British officer, in 1899, quarter column and close order maneuvers were both indispensable and reassuringly familiar, and they were effective tactics against ill-armed tribal warriors or native rebels. But they were not good tactics when advancing across open ground towards fixed entrenchments manned by men with magazine rifles and prototype machine guns. Although small by European standards, the British Army was a professional army. The men signed on for a shilling a day for a minimum of 6 years. Life in the army was exceptionally hard, and commissions for enlisted men were virtually unheard of. The ranks were consequently not a place for men of ambition, means, or education. Much of the British Army was composed of regiments raised in Ireland or the Highland areas of Scotland, and of men for whom the Army, whatever its shortcomings, promised a temporary refuge from the vicious cycle of rural destitution and urban poverty. The officers were, by contrast, drawn from the other extreme, the sons of Britain's substantial aristocracy. Furthermore, the army was principally designed for putting down native rebellions. And to most of the officers, the Boer invasion was essentially just another native rebellion. This perceived role of the army and the social gulf between officers and men was reflected in the training regimes and the prevailing tactical doctrines in the army. The emphasis was on discipline and on keeping the men in order. Little importance was attached to marksmanship, and the soldiers were given only rudimentary instruction in aiming and firing. The overriding tactical doctrines which had persisted throughout the 19th century placed the emphasis on firing by volley and on close order marching advances. Much of a soldier's service was spent in endlessly drilling in these maneuvers. Yet for all that, the British infantryman in 1899 was a remarkable fellow. Rarely able to read, write, or even shoot properly, he was often capable of incredible, almost reckless courage, and of enduring hardships with a common soldier's humor and stoical resignation. The Boer army could not have been more different. It was a true citizen's army. Every man between the ages of 16 and 60 was eligible for service and required by law to provide his own horse and rifle. Since 1895, this elementary provision had been augmented by the state, and at the outbreak of war, virtually all those eligible for service possessed at least one good horse and the latest German Mauser 7mm rifle. The Mauser was indisputably the best rifle in the world. It was a high-velocity, long-range rifle designed to be rapidly reloaded with clips of 5 smokeless powder cartridges. At a distance, the absence of smoke made the rifle fire almost invisible. At closer ranges, and fired horizontally into advancing formations, the high-velocity bullets were capable of killing or wounding more than one soldier at a time. And the Boers could shoot. At a time when all military textbooks agreed on the impossibility of directing accurate rifle fire at distances greater than 800 yards, the Boers, untutored in modern military theory, demonstrated an alarmingly consistent accuracy at 1,200 yards. It was this fatal combination of entrenchments and accuracy and volume of horizontal fire that turned the strategic and tactical blunders of Black Week into disasters. 15 years later, the British Army would find itself on the banks of another Tugela, just as ill-prepared and just as vulnerable. And, as on the Tugela, the British infantry on the Somme would have to pay the butcher's bill. For Buller, Black Week was a personal disaster. 2 days after losing his guns outside Colenso, he was replaced as Commander-in-Chief in South Africa by Field Marshal Roberts. In contrast to Buller, Roberts had spent most of his service life in the East. In 1858, Roberts had won the Victoria Cross as a lieutenant in the Indian Mutiny. After further distinguished service in the Second Afghan War of 1878, Roberts served as Commander-in-Chief in India and then in Ireland. At 67, Roberts knew he was approaching the end of his service career. His ultimate ambition, to succeed Wolseley as Commander-in-Chief of the Army, had for years appeared blocked by Buller's preferment as Wolseley's protege and ally. In the battle for Colenso, Roberts' rivalry with Buller had been given a further tragic twist. Among the casualties had been Roberts' only son. Lieutenant Freddie Roberts had been killed in a brave but ultimately vain attempt to rescue Buller's guns. Abandoned on the vulnerable southern bank of the Tugela. Roberts' appointment was to signal a new determination by Britain. The disasters of Black Week had unnerved the government and shaken public confidence in the army. The continuing investment of White at Ladysmith and of the garrisons at Kimberley and Mafeking threatened to undermine Britain's credibility in the eyes of the world. In the first months of the war, the Boers had proved themselves formidable enemies, and their generals more imaginative and more daring than their British counterparts. In the absence of quality, Britain at least could always rely upon quantity, and 1900 would find the full weight of the empire brought to bear on the conflict. Volunteers from Britain would be joined by volunteers from Canada, Australia, and New Zealand. By the end of the war, nearly 500,000 British and colonial troops would see service in the region. In 1899, the Boer republics of the Transvaal and the Orange Free State had gone to war with Britain, invading the British dominions of Natal and the Cape, and laying siege to the towns of Ladysmith, Kimberley, and Mafeking. The Transvaal president, Paul Kruger, had believed that war was inevitable and that his people's independence was gravely threatened by Britain's imperial ambitions for the region. In the last decade of the 19th century, gold mining had transformed the Transvaal from one of the poorest to one of the richest countries in the world, upsetting the balance of power and undermining Britain's hitherto undisputed dominance in the area. Gold also enabled the Boers to arm themselves with the most modern European weapons, enhancing their traditional marksmanship to an astonishing accuracy. In the first months of their war, the Boers had inflicted a series of crushing reverses on the British. But their natural caution had prevented them from following up these victories and overrunning large areas of the Cape. The new century found them holding essentially defensive positions on the frontiers of their own lands. Time, however, was not on their side. For months, British troops had been disembarking in the Cape ports in ever-increasing numbers. In December, General Buller had been replaced as commander-in-chief of Britain's forces in the region by Field Marshal Roberts. Roberts' appointment signalled, if anything, a hardening of resolve. Roberts arrived in Cape Town on January the 10th, 1900. Fresh troops were now arriving every day. By the end of the war, there would be almost 250,000 British and colonial soldiers in the region. By the beginning of February, there were 50,000 in the Southern Cape alone. It was this army that Roberts now led across the Orange River and into the Free State. At Ramdam, Roberts detached a division of cavalry under the command of General John French and sent this force sweeping around the principal Boer forces encamped at Magersfontein. On February the 13th, French seized Clip Drift on the Modder River, establishing passage of the river for the following divisions of Roberts' main army. On February the 15th, French reached the outskirts of Kimberley. Simultaneously dissolving the investment and precipitating a general retreat of the remaining Boer forces between Kimberley and the Modder. Two days later, units of French's cavalry intercepted the main Boer force retreating eastwards along the Modder to Bloemfontein. Almost immediately, units from Roberts' main army began arriving from the south, and by noon of the following day, nearly 5,000 Boers were surrounded by 17,000 British infantry supported by artillery. The Boers held out for 10 days, demonstrating remarkable resilience in the face of overwhelming odds and almost ceaseless shelling. Their capitulation on February the 27th brought Britain her first major victory of the war. In Natal, however, Buller's efforts to relieve Ladysmith had met with two further disasters. In mid-January, Buller had seized two bridgeheads across the Tugela after a flank march of some 20 miles. But the operation had been conducted so laboriously and with such a lack of coordination that the Boers had been able to fortify the high ground commanding the north bank of the river. On January the 23rd, Buller launched his offensive against Spion Kop, a precipitous and rocky crag in the center of the range. In the early hours of the following morning, the British stormed over the crest of the hill, routing the Boers and seizing an exposed ridge. For 24 hours, the fighting raged back and forwards. The Boers, holding adjacent peaks, maintained a lethal crossfire on the British positions. The casualties were appalling. Throughout the 24th, the flanks of Spion Kop teemed with the passage of reinforcements ascending and the stretcher teams bringing down the wounded. Daybreak on the 25th found the summit abandoned. The British had withdrawn under cover of darkness. They had suffered nearly 1,500 casualties, more even than they had sustained at Colenso. For 2 days, the Boer pickets on Spion Kop watched as the caravans and ambulance wagons of Buller's army wound their way back over the plain and across the Tugela towards the waiting field hospitals behind the flanks of Mount Alice. A further effort at Waalkrantz in early February produced only a further crop of casualties and another ignominious retreat across the Tugela. For his fourth and final effort to force the river, Buller employed tactics that were, by the standards of the time, quite revolutionary. After seizing the high ground to the east of Colenso by a flank attack, Buller sent his infantry across the river under cover of a rolling artillery screen. Gone was the emphasis on set-piece frontal attacks and on keeping the men in order. Instead, individual units were encouraged to show initiative and stealth and to advance independently and in stages as the opportunities arose. The artillery was now employed for the first time in direct support of the infantry, providing creeping barrages and concentrating on enemy strong points and obstacles to the main infantry thrust. There were, of course, mistakes and misunderstandings, but the new tactics proved the key to unlocking the line of hills and ridges blocking the road to Ladysmith. On February the 27th, Buller's army at last emerged from the mountain flanks of the Tugela and began advancing across the empty veld towards Ladysmith. For Buller, the journey from Colenso had been one of the longest and most arduous in his entire career, and he could claim no decisive victory in the field. When their fortifications on the Tugela had been breached, the Boers had melted away to the north. There, in the high passes of northern Natal, they would stand and face Buller again. Five days after Buller reached Ladysmith, Gattaca occupied Stormberg. And on March the 13th, Roberts entered the undefended Free State capital of Bloemfontein. For the Boers, any hopes of a decisive victory were now beginning to evaporate. Roberts was to remain in Bloemfontein for 6 weeks. Initially, this was seen as a period of consolidation, rest, and resupply. The troops were exhausted, their uniforms were tattered, and their boots disintegrating on their feet. The cavalry needed new horses, and the army in general needed fresh supplies of ammunition and field rations for the troops. Problems of supply had become chronic the further north the army had advanced. Bloemfontein marked the effective limit of the first stage of that advance, and its single-track railway link to the Cape provided an increasingly tenuous and congested supply line. The town itself suffered from a congestion that completely overwhelmed both the water supply and the rudimentary sanitation system. A typhoid epidemic swept through the camps clustered on the arid veld around Bloemfontein. By the beginning of April, the epidemic had claimed over 1,000 lives and was to rage intermittently for the remainder of the conflict. of the 20,000 British troops who were to lose their lives in the Boer War, more than half would die of typhoid. The early months of 1900 also saw the first opening shots in the second phase of the war. In February, the Free State leader, Christian De Wet, had seized a convoy of 200 wagons at Waterval Drift. In March, De Wet had surprised another supply column at Korn Spruit, 20 miles outside Bloemfontein, capturing over 100 wagons, more than 400 prisoners, and 7 guns. In April, De Wet struck again at Reddersburg and at Weppenau, taking a further 600 captives before being driven off by relief columns from Robert's main army. Although dismissed at the time as the last desperate actions of a defeated enemy, the raids marked the beginning of the guerrilla war, an increasingly bitter conflict that would persist for a further 2 years. On May the 17th, Mafeking was at last relieved by flying columns from the north and south. On the 24th, the Free State was formally incorporated as a dependent territory of the British Empire. 2 days later, the first units of Robert's colossal army reached the Vaal and began advancing through the Transvaal towards Johannesburg. Five days later, Roberts reached Johannesburg, capturing the gold mines and the deserted commercial capital of the Rand. On June the 5th, Roberts entered Pretoria. He found it, like Johannesburg, largely deserted and undefended. At the end of May, Kruger had abandoned the capital, fleeing with the remnants of his government to the Mozambique frontier. In September, he would sail for Europe, never to return. Throughout the first southern winter of the war, from May through to August, Buller advanced steadily, elbowing his way through the Drakensberg and over the Natal passes. In contrast with his earlier battles on the Tugela, Buller's new methods were a model of economy and effectiveness. At every tortuous twist and turn, he outmaneuvered Botha, conserving his forces and driving the Boers out onto the far less defensible plains of the Eastern Transvaal. At the end of August, Buller fought the last set-piece battle of the war. The remnants of Botha's army, still some 7,000 strong, had entrenched themselves along a line of hills, ridges and ravines commanding the railway line connecting the Transvaal to the Mozambique frontier and the coast. In the center of the range, one hill proved the tactical key to Botha's position. Using the by now well-practiced techniques of tightly coordinated artillery and infantry assaults, Buller seized the hill at minimal cost, thereby collapsing the entire Boer front and precipitating Kruger's subsequent flight into exile. For the next 2 months, Buller's forces advanced through the Eastern Transvaal, chasing a dispirited and disintegrating Boer army from redoubt to redoubt. In a string of engagements among the ravines and escarpments of the northern Drakensberg, Buller's veterans suffered less than 100 casualties. It was all so very different in the West. Roberts had not defeated the Free State Army or the Boer forces in the Western Transvaal. He had merely swept them aside, believing that the capture of their capitals would compel the Boers to surrender. It was a fatal error of judgment. The Boers were not an urban people and had no European sentimentality for their towns. Even the formal annexation of the Transvaal in October 1900 failed to impress upon them that the war was lost. As the great columns lumbered over the veldt or toiled along the tracks of the railway, they encountered almost no resistance to their passage. In their wake, the Boer commandos struck savagely. Attacking garrisons, snapping up convoys, cutting the rail and telegraph lines, and riding away with as much plunder as they could carry. By now, many of the commandos were equipping themselves with captured British weapons. The perilous and sometimes dilapidated state of Roberts' supply lines ensured them a ready supply of ammunition. In a raid on the rail station at Rudewal, De Wet captured so much equipment that after loading his horses and wagons, and even his prisoners with booty, he was forced to put to the torch a surplus worth almost £500,000. At the end of the year, Buller and Roberts left for London. Roberts to be awarded a peerage and to be appointed Commander-in-Chief of the Army in succession to Wolseley. Buller to be made a scapegoat for the humiliations of the previous year. The new Commander-in-Chief of Britain's forces in the region and the man charged with rounding up the remaining renegades was General Kitchener. Kitchener had earned a reputation in the Sudan for vigorous and determined leadership. He had served as Roberts' chief of staff during the long march from Cape Town to Pretoria. He knew the country and the people. Yet it was to take Kitchener a further 18 months to bring the war to an end. Throughout the long South African summer, from November 1900 through to March 1901, the Boer commandos ranged with seeming impunity over the veldt. De Wet in the Free State, now renamed the Orange River Colony, Louis Botha in the Eastern Transvaal, and Coos de la Rey in the mountain ranges of the West. And these were merely the largest groups. There were many more, ranging in size from a couple of dozen to a couple of thousand. Nor were they disorganized,